Hey guys, welcome to my channel. Did you know that one of the world's most ambitious engineering marvels is unfolding in China? It is not only reshaping the natural landscape, but also transforming the future of millions of people. Welcome to a deep exploration of China's Pinglu Canal Project, an undertaking so massive that it is altering the very structure of the nation. In today's discussion, we will uncover the untold stories behind this epic project. Before we officially start the video, we sincerely invite you to subscribe and turn on notifications to ensure you don't miss any of our exciting content updates. From the sweeping geographic and demographic changes it brings, to the groundbreaking engineering technologies involved, and the complex environmental and social impacts. Join China as we decode this monumental project. It not only showcases the wonders of modern engineering, but also highlights the controversies and challenges it faces. Is this massive project the solution China has long been seeking? Or is it a colossal problem yet to be conquered? China's geography has played a crucial role in shaping its civilization and agricultural development. This vast country is home to diverse terrains, from the fertile plains along the Yangtze River to the arid expanses of the north. These geographical contrasts have not only influenced agricultural practices, but also shaped the historical development of communities across the nation. Let's begin with this map of China. Excluding Taiwan and the islands of the South China Sea, it marks 55 coastal cities in China. Among them, the vast majority have played vital roles in the country's economy, trade, transportation, and culture. Yet in the southwest corner of the map, the three coastal cities of Guangxi, Qinzhou, Beihai, and Fangchengang have long remained a hidden corner under the halo of China's coast. Despite being born with natural deep-water harbors and holding the golden key of being China's only province-level region, directly connected to ASEAN by both land and sea, Guangxi has never received the status and attention it deserves. Even today, though the Beibu Gulf port has entered the top 10 Chinese ports by cargo throughput, when people mention Guangxi's coast, it is still seen merely as a destination of beautiful beaches and affordable vacations, rather than a hub of maritime ambition, prosperity, and strength. Guangxi's sea is modest, and its rivers seem even more reserved. Flowing through it is the Xizhang River, Guangxi's most important water system and one of China's busiest inland waterways. Each year, over 200 million tons of cargo pass through the Xizhang, but most of it eventually flows into the Pearl River Delta. Blocked by the 10,000 Great Mountains, this golden waterway nourishes a world-class bay area, yet it has little chance to directly benefit its own hinterland. Despite being coastal, Guangxi lacks a direct river-to-sea corridor. The world is clearly close, yet Guangxi has been forced to take the long way around. This is not only Guangxi's helplessness, but also a regret for the entire waterway system of southwest China. It is time to cut through the mountains with a canal to connect rivers to the sea. The Pinglu Canal is the first canal built since the founding of New China, and a century-defining project after the Grand Canal. The Pinglu Canal is a vital part of the new Western land-sea corridor. It serves as a 100-million-ton level water transport artery linking the Pearl River Zhejiang River Basin with the Beibu Gulf Port. Upstream, it connects with the Zhejiang shipping mainline, known as the Golden Waterway. To the west, it extends via the Yongjiang River directly to Nanning and the Zuo and Yu Rivers, reaching into Yunnan. To the east, it flows through the Yujiang River straight to the Guangdong, Hong Kong, Macau, Greater Bay Area. To the north, it connects through the Qianzheng, Hongshui, or Liujiang Rivers to Guizhou. To the south, it flows out into the Beibu Gulf. The Pinglu Canal has a total length of about 140 kilometers. It starts from the Pingtang River estuary of the Shijin Reservoir in Hangzhou, about 150 kilometers downstream of the Yongjiang River in Nanning. From there, it crosses the watershed between the Shaping River and the Jiuzhou tributary of the Qinjiang River, runs through Luwu Town in Lingshan County, Qinzhou City, follows the mainstream of the Qinjiang River southward, and finally enters the waters of Qinzhou Port in the Beibu Gulf. Construction officially began in August 2022, with a planned duration of 52 months. The main structure is scheduled to be completed by the end of 2026. This new canal will become China's first major artificial canal in more than 1,400 years since the famous Grand Canal itself. It will link the inland river system directly to the sea. This time, Guangxi's rivers will flow southward directly into the sea rather than detouring through the more economically developed neighboring province of Guangdong. In fact, China has been considering digging such a new canal for decades. As you can see, the distance from Nanning to the Beibu Gulf is very short, just over 100 kilometers. The new canal will shorten the travel distance by 560 kilometers, which translates into about 10 days saved in transportation time. However, the Pinglu Canal comes at a hefty cost, with investment exceeding $10 billion. Is it truly worth it? The answer is certainly yes. Water transport is cheaper than road or rail. In addition, China has adopted a very conservative approach to forecasting returns, assuming that the investment will break even in 30 years. Yet the canal itself can last at least a century with minimal maintenance costs. To fully understand the economic benefits, one must also consider the additional 800 kilometers saved if cargo from Guangxi is destined for ASEAN countries. The canal will directly connect inland rivers to maritime trade with ASEAN nations, offering massive potential. Moreover, China already has methods in place to accelerate upstream and downstream cargo transport. The Pinglu Canal is designed with three locks, capable of accommodating ships of up to 5,000 tons. These locks will feature smart traffic guidance through data sharing. In China, only some sections of the Yangtze River can handle such large vessels, so the designers of the Pinglu Canal have clearly anticipated and planned for heavy shipping traffic in the future. Over the past decade, trade between Guangxi and ASEAN has accounted for nearly half of Guangxi's total trade, with its value almost tripling and its annual growth rate far exceeding the national average. All infrastructure construction is closely tied to market expectations. The Pinglu Canal will promote supply chain connections across industries such as automobiles and petrochemicals. Not only Guangxi, but also provinces in central and western China will benefit from it. As China accelerates the construction of river transport infrastructure, projects like the Pinglu Canal will usher in the next stage of economic growth and social empowerment. At first glance, it might seem like just a massive construction site, bulldozers, cranes, endless concrete. But in reality, what you are witnessing is China building its first major canal in over a millennium. And it's not just anywhere. It cuts through the most rugged terrain of southern China. You may have already marveled at China's construction speed, bridges spanning entire gorges, railways piercing mountains. But this time, they are doing something different. This is the Pinglu Canal, one of the most ambitious infrastructure projects in China in recent years. The Pinglu Canal stretches 134.2 kilometers, starting at the Pingtang River estuary of the Xijin Reservoir in Hangzhou and ending at the Qinjiang River flowing into the Beibu Gulf. This final connection to the sea is the key to the canal's significance. It transforms Guangxi's inland hinterland into a potential export hub. China has a long history of constructing artificial canals. The most famous is the Grand Canal, which stretches over 1,700 kilometers and has supported the nation's economic operations for centuries. From a bird's eye view, we can easily spot the unique characteristics of the Grand Canal. On the plains of eastern China, it is the only north-south channel among all the east-flowing rivers. It not only links up the five major river systems, namely Hat River, Yellow River, Huai River, Yangtze River, and Shantung River, but also connects dozens of cities along the way, including Beijing, Tianjin, Jining, Yangzhou, and Hangzhou, all by itself. And it has been flowing for the last 2,500 years or so. It transported grain from the fertile southern regions to the political centers in the north and unified the national transport system during the Sui and Tang dynasties. However, after that golden age of water transport, China gradually shifted its focus to highways, railways, and aviation, especially after the 20th century. Water transport took a back seat. For over 1,000 years, China did not build any new large-scale artificial canals. So why revive this idea now? The reason is that China's economic landscape has changed. While the eastern coastal provinces remain manufacturing powerhouses, the central and western provinces, such as Guizhou, Yunnan, and Sichuan, are rapidly developing. These regions are far from the sea, and transporting factory goods to ports like Shanghai or Shenzhen takes both time and money. The canal offers a more efficient alternative, cheaper than rail, more energy-saving than trucks, and capable of transporting large volumes of cargo. This is the significance of the Pinglu Canal, not just reviving an ancient tradition, but solving modern logistics challenges. Just as the Grand Canal once transformed internal trade in ancient China, this canal will connect China's new regions to global markets. But this project is more than just pouring concrete. It involves logistics, strategy, economics, and possibly even political considerations. Theoretically, digging a 134-kilometer canal through hills and rivers might seem excessive, especially in a country with some of the world's busiest highways and advanced high-speed rail. But this is not about showing off. It's about solving a very real logistics problem. Many areas in western and southwestern China, such as Chongqing, Guizhou, and Sichuan, are industrially dense, with factories, coal mines, steel plants, and cement factories. But they share a common problem. They are landlocked, far from the sea. Transporting goods from these regions to eastern coastal ports like Shanghai or Shenzhen usually requires over 700 to 1,000 kilometers of travel, which is slow, costly, and heavily reliant on already overburdened railways and highways. The Pinglu Canal changes all of this. It provides these inland provinces with a direct waterway to the Beibu Gulf, which is crucial for companies shipping bulk goods. Even small transportation savings could determine profits or losses. This is not only a logistical improvement, but also part of a larger strategic plan. The canal plays a key role in China's new international land-sea trade corridor, linking railways, highways, and waterways, especially connecting underdeveloped Western regions directly to Southeast Asia and global markets. Construction officially began in August 2023, with a total budget of approximately $10 billion, and completion is expected in 2026. Once operational, ships will be able to transport goods between inland factories and international ports without using any highways or railways. The canal is designed to accommodate vessels up to 5,000 tons, primarily for bulk cargo. At full capacity, it is expected to transport over 95 million tons of cargo annually, roughly twice the early shipping volume of the Panama Canal. However, building a giant canal from scratch is no easy task, especially in uneven terrain. The Pinglu Canal must traverse mountains, hills, rivers, and villages, requiring road diversions, resident relocations, and terrain reshaping. The scale of work is enormous, with extremely precise requirements. Elevation differences exist along various parts of the canal, which is why three large locks, essentially water staircases, have been designed. The largest, the Tantang Lock, will be the largest water-saving lock ever built, allowing large vessels to navigate steep slopes while minimizing water consumption. This is particularly crucial in regions where seasonal droughts may cause water shortages. Along the canal, there are more than 90 bridges and over 40 kilometers of excavation zones, including several deep rock cuts. In some areas, up to 13 million cubic meters of earth must be removed, equivalent to more than 5,000 Olympic-sized swimming pools. Unlike older canals, this canal is built to modern standards. Reinforced embankments, automated water control systems, and integration with intelligent logistics platforms. Thousands of workers and dozens of heavy machines, excavators, dredgers, and concrete pumps operate around the clock. Coordinating construction along such a long and narrow corridor is itself an engineering challenge. Once completed, the canal will function more like a highway than a traditional waterway, efficiently handling high-volume traffic with low maintenance costs. When people think of canals that transform cargo flows, they usually think of the Panama Canal and the Suez Canal, which connect oceans. The Pinglu Canal, however, is an inland canal linking rivers to a gulf, so it does not compete with Panama or Suez in global shipping. But that is not the point. Panama and Suez are shortcuts for international shipping, while the Pinglu Canal focuses on domestic efficiency. Despite its lesser fame, it is strategically just as important for China. At full capacity, the Pinglu Canal can handle over 95 million tons of cargo annually. This is not just an impressive number, it represents a major shift in how goods flow in southern China. Previously, cargo from inland factories to coastal ports had to travel 700 to 1,000 kilometers by truck or train, time-consuming and costly. This is especially significant for heavy materials like coal, cement, grain, or steel. The canal allows goods to float directly to the coast, cheaper, faster, and with lower emissions. Some routes are expected to shorten travel distances by up to 560 kilometers, saving about a day of transport time. This is a major benefit for China's inland provinces. Cities like Luzhou and Nanning, previously far from main shipping routes, now have the opportunity to become regional trade hubs. Industrial parks, logistics centers, and export zones are already being planned along the canal. The ports of the Beibu Gulf, especially Qinzhou, Fengchengang, and Beihai, were previously considered second-tier ports, but with the continuous influx of inland cargo via the canal, they are becoming key players in China's overall trade strategy. Nationwide, the canal gives China greater control over internal logistics. No longer entirely dependent on a few eastern megacities, the country now has new routes to transport goods to Southeast Asia and beyond. In a time when global supply chains are under constant pressure, this flexibility is extremely important. The Pinglu Canal also strengthens China's trade links with Vietnam, Thailand, and Malaysia, creating a southern trade route that bypasses Taiwan or some sensitive South China Sea passages. In short, it is not just infrastructure, it is a strategic lever. Of course, large-scale construction projects always involve trade-offs. Excavating 134 kilometers of land inevitably affects local residents and the environment. Thousands of residents along the route have been relocated and many villages cleared. The government has provided compensation plans, but not everyone is satisfied. For older residents, losing ancestral land or being forced to leave long-established communities is not just about money, it concerns identity, history, and emotional attachment to the land. Environmentally, the canal passes through wetlands, farmland, forests, and biodiversity areas, placing pressure on local ecosystems, including fish, migratory birds, and groundwater resources. To mitigate this, the government and engineering teams have implemented multiple protective measures: ecological corridors, water-saving locks, real-time monitoring systems, sediment interception, and drainage facilities to prevent erosion and sediment damage to the rivers. Experts point out that these measures require long-term supervision and maintenance, especially during extreme weather, such as floods or droughts. The canal draws water from the Yujiang Reservoir in Hangzhou, which could affect agriculture and residential water use during dry seasons. Engineers state that this has been accounted for with reservoirs and water diversion systems, but uncertainties remain under climate change. Additionally, although water transport is generally more environmentally friendly than road transport, increased shipping brings risks of higher emissions, noise, fuel spills, or cargo leakage, particularly in previously quiet rural areas. Once fully operational, the canal will not only transport goods, but could fundamentally transform how southern and western China participate in global trade. Local governments anticipate the canal transporting millions of tons of cargo annually, and as industrial zones, export hubs, and manufacturing parks develop along the route, this number could increase even further. However, such ambitious plans also carry risks. One major concern is underutilization. If companies do not adjust their logistics to fully leverage the canal, it could, like other large projects, remain partially unused after completion. Long-term maintenance is also a challenge. Locks, bridges, and automated systems require ongoing upkeep, especially during dry seasons when water levels and sediment accumulation need monitoring. Environmental management is another test. Despite official promises of real-time monitoring, responding to climate change and water resource pressures will require continuous investment and transparency. There is also a balancing issue. Can the canal provide economic opportunities without causing permanent damage to the environment and vulnerable communities? This is a matter that local governments must carefully manage over the long term. Undeniably, China is doing something that no other country in the world has attempted: building a high-tech inland canal system at record speed while addressing economic and strategic concerns. The Pinglu Canal may not make headlines like the Suez or Panama canals, but it is equally important for China. This is a $10 billion infrastructure bet designed to activate inland trade, reduce transportation costs, and give the country more control over its supply chains. Construction is progressing rapidly, and China is betting on its success. If this project succeeds, the canal could become a benchmark for other countries around the world to reconnect their inland regions and reduce reliance on trucks and railways. So what do you think? Should more countries build inland canals to ease traffic congestion and lower logistics costs? Or are the environmental, social, and financial risks simply too high? Share your thoughts in the comments below, and don't forget to hit the subscribe button to join our channel. We'll see you in the next video.